So welcome everyone to the second lecture in the series of four lectures by Professor Adrian Moore. My name is Sebastian Sunday-Grieve. I'm an assistant professor at Peking University and a member of the Chinese Institute of Foreign Philosophy. And it'll be my great honor to be your host again today. As in the previous meeting, I will begin with a brief introduction of our speaker and our panelists. Adrian Moore, our speaker, is professor of philosophy and lecturer in philosophy at the University of Oxford, as well as tutorial fellow of St. Hugh's College, Oxford. He studied philosophy first as an undergraduate at Cambridge and later at Oxford, where he obtained his doctorate under the supervision of Michael Dummett. Since 2015, he has been joint editor together with Lucy O'Brien of the famous philosophy journal Mind. He has published many books and articles on a broad range of philosophical issues, historical, theoretical, as well as practical ones, including important issues in metaphysics, philosophy of mathematics, philosophy of logic and language, ethics, and philosophy of religion. His most recently published books are a collection of his essays under the title Language, World, and Limits, Essays in the Philosophy of Language and Metaphysics, published by Oxford University Press in 2019. And in the same year, the third edition of his influential The Infinite, published by Routledge, that's the same press who also published the original edition of The Infinite 31 years ago in the year 1990. This series of lectures is entitled A History of the Infinite. There'll be four lectures in total. Today is the second one, and there'll be two more, one on Wednesday and one next Friday. Each time, Professor Moore will lecture for about 1 hour, and then there'll be approximately 1 more hour for discussion. There'll be an audience Q&A, questions and answers, and there will be a panel discussion. So like last time, we have been very lucky to be able to attract 4 great experts from various Chinese universities to join our panel. And so it's my great honor and pleasure to welcome and briefly introduce now our panelists tonight. First of all, welcome to Professor Chen Bo, who joins us another time from Wuhan University. Hello, Professor Chen Bo. And Professor Mei Jianhua from Shanxi University. Professor Sun Yongping, my colleague at Peking University. Hello. And Dr. Yan Xunling from the Chinese Academy of Sciences. Welcome, all of you, and thanks for accepting our invitation. I will also introduce each panelist in a little bit more detail after today's lecture at the beginning of our panel discussion. And after that panel discussion, there will be the audience Q&A. Now, for that purpose, we will be collecting short questions and comments from the live streams, both on Bilibili and on YouTube, which all audience members are invited to post at any time during the lecture or the discussion. And we will then present to Professor Moore some of these questions and comments, as many as possible, of course, so that he may provide his answers. And all of the selected questions and comments will also be saved and shared with him after the event. So now, finally, before we begin, I would like to briefly thank the institutions who are mainly supporting this event, namely Peking University, and in particular, my department, that's the Department of Philosophy and Religious Studies, Peking University, also the university's Office of International Relations, as well as the Chinese Institute of Foreign Philosophy. So now it's time for me to welcome again Professor Adrian Moore in order to share with us more of his thought and insights concerning the infinite in the form of his second lecture. And as you may remember, the title of his first lecture was The Infinite in Ancient and medieval thought. The title of the second lecture now is The Infinite in Science and Technology. So welcome, Adrian. You may begin now.
Thank you very much indeed, Sebastian. I would like to do the same thing that I did at the beginning of my first lecture, which is to thank you very much for your kind introduction and for your kind invitation to give these lectures. And once again, I'd like to express my gratitude to the institutions that have made this possible and to the panelists who will be presenting their questions after the lecture. Now, as in the first lecture, I'm going to begin by sharing my screen with you. And as before, what this is a handout, which I shall be scrolling through as I give the lecture. And those of you that attended the first lecture will probably remember that some of the material on the handout was in black. As you can see on the screen in front of you, all this material is in black. And there is also some material later on that's in red. And just to remind you of the significance of that distinction, the material that's in red all consists of quotations from other people, and I shall be reading those out in full. The material in black is a kind of summary of what I myself am saying in between those quotations and gives the gist of my own presentation. And this particular lecture begins with material in black, and so I'm, as it were, going to launch straight into some of my own ideas. But before I do even that, let me pick up on a very interesting question that was posed at the end of my first lecture. Again, those of you that were in attendance the day before yesterday may remember that one of the questions that arose was the question, how far any of these issues about infinity have practical significance, practical repercussions. And I think it's fair to say straight away that one thing that we will be seeing today is that the answer to that question is that they have very significant practical repercussions. Precisely what we will be doing today is looking at how, in both science and technology, the idea of the infinite gets applied, and the use that scientists and engineers and technologists make of the idea of infinity. And very, very roughly speaking, today's lecture will be divided into two. In the first half of the lecture, I shall be considering issues that arise in connection with the infinitely small. And in the second half of the lecture, attention will turn to issues in connection with the infinitely big. So we begin by looking at how ideas of the infinitely small have been of practical relevance. And straightway, what that means is that we shall be looking at the calculus, because the calculus is a branch of mathematics which, in some very fundamental sense, is concerned with the infinitely small. So let me proceed to the material on the handout that you can see on the screen. And I'm pretty much just going to read through this at first, just to orient today's lecture. So the first thing that I say on the handout is that attention now turns from philosophical and theological thought about the infinite to scientific applications of the concept. So that's a reminder of what today's focus is and how that differs from the focus a couple of days ago in lecture one, where we were considering the ways in which philosophers and theologians had grappled with the concept of infinity. It's now very much a matter of what scientists and mathematicians are doing with the concept of infinity. And we begin, as I say on the handout, we begin with the invention of the calculus, which makes precise some of the ideas that people have had when trying to reckon with the infinitely small, and without which science, business, and technology these days would all be literally unthinkable. From the design of aircraft to the design of irrigation channels, from the prediction of birth rates to the computation of marginal costs and revenues, from the calculation of an optimal projection angle for putting a shot to the estimation of how much a tumor will shrink in a given time with effective chemotherapy, the calculus is at work throughout our lives. Now, what I've just done is read out a list of examples of ways in which the calculus has been of practical significance. And some of that may have meant something to you, and some of that may have meant nothing to you. And if it did mean nothing to you, that doesn't really matter. I mean, the details of those examples are not important. Whether or not you know quite what's meant by marginal costs and revenues, whether or not you have any sense of what's involved in calculating the optimal projection angle for putting a shot, whether or not you know what it even is to put a shot, those matters are irrelevant, really. It's just a list of examples, a list of very varied examples of why the calculus is so important, has been so important ever since its invention. But what I'm going to do initially is just try to give you a sense of what the calculus is and how it works. And so this is material that's not on the handout, and I hope you'll be able to follow the gist of what I'm about to say. And my apologies in advance to those of you for whom this is already very familiar, but I'm hoping that this will be helpful and useful for those people to whom this is not already familiar. So basically, the calculus is concerned with measuring rates of change. So all sorts of things change in all sorts of ways over the course of time, and they can change more or less rapidly, more or less slowly. And we're very often interested in the rate at which something is changing. And what the calculus is concerned with is the methods that we can use to measure those rates. Now, let's take perhaps the simplest and most obvious example of the kind of thing that I have in mind, which is motion through space. An object moving from one point in space to another. That's a kind of change. Obviously, that's a change of location, a change of position in space. And that'll be a change that has a rate. And in that particular case, the rate of change is the speed at which the object is moving. So let's imagine a train, for example, that travels from A to B. And let's imagine that the distance between A and B is exactly 60 miles. And let's also imagine that the train takes exactly 1 hour to get from A to B. So this train travels 60 miles in an hour. What can we say about the speed of the train? Well, obviously, one thing that we can say straight away is that its average speed throughout that journey is 60 miles an hour. What it did was it traveled 60 miles in an hour, and therefore its average speed was 60 miles an hour. But of course, it does not follow that the train was always traveling at 60 miles an hour throughout the journey. So it's possible, for example, that it traveled very quickly during the first half hour and managed to cover two thirds of its journey. So perhaps in the first half hour, it covered 40 miles of those 60 miles. And what that means is that during the first half hour, it was averaging 80 miles an hour. It was traveling much more quickly than its overall average. And then maybe because of some sort of signal failure, or who knows, something delays the train. And in the second half hour, it's traveling much more slowly and only covers the remaining 20 miles during that half hour. And what this goes to show is that it can have an average speed of 60 miles an hour throughout its journey without constantly traveling at 60 miles an hour, without that being its speed throughout the entire journey. And if we're interested in its average speed in the first half hour, we have to consider how far it travels in that half hour and the time it takes to do so, which, if we're imagining the first half hour, the time it takes to do so is half an hour. And similarly, in the second half hour, we can consider its average speed by considering how far it travels during that half hour. But now imagine that in the course of this journey, the train driver at a particular moment looks at the speedometer and notices that at that particular point, the train is traveling at 70 miles an hour, let's say. Now, that's certainly something that can happen. And people that drive cars similarly will occasionally look at their speedometer to see what speed they're traveling at. And we take this sort of thing for granted. It seems to make perfectly good sense to say that the train is traveling at 70 miles an hour at a particular moment. But what does this mean? What does it mean to say that the train is traveling at 70 miles an hour at a particular moment? We can say that its average speed throughout the entire journey is 60 miles an hour because it covers 60 miles in an hour. But at a particular moment, it's not covering any distance and it's not taking any time. If we ask what it's doing at that moment or how it's changing at that moment, it looks as if we have to say, well, it's moving no distance at all and it's taking no time at all. Or possibly, if we want to talk in terms of the infinitely small, we might want to say, well, it's traveling an infinitely small distance and it's taking an infinitely small amount of time to do so. Those are the sorts of things that we're tempted to say, but they don't really make sense. And in particular, if we're going to talk in those terms, it's hard to see how we can say that the speed at that particular moment is 70 miles an hour. If you travel an infinitely small distance in an infinitely small amount of time, why does that mean that you're traveling at 70 miles an hour as opposed to 60 miles an hour or 80 miles an hour? And this is precisely the sort of problem that the calculus is designed to address. The calculus is a set of mathematical methods that enable us to give some sense to the question, what is the speed of a moving object at a particular time? And I can't go into the details now. That would be far too much for this lecture. But suffice to say that, roughly speaking, the way that the calculus manages to achieve this is not by considering that particular moment as an infinitely small moment during which the train travels an infinitely small distance. Rather, what the calculus does is that it considers the various portions of time and space that overlap that instant, all the periods that include that point, the point at which the train driver looks at his speedometer, and it considers those overlapping periods, and it considers what happens as they get smaller and smaller and smaller, and notices the way in which there's a tendency there for the average speed of the train towards 70 miles an hour. I hope that explanation gives you some sense of what's going on. That's not very precise, and the methods of the calculus are designed to make it more precise. But the important thing for current purposes is that what the calculus is a way of giving precise sense to the idea of measuring change at a particular point. And then that in turn has all of these practical repercussions, some of which are listed there on the handout. Now, I'm going to turn attention now from the actual mathematics of it to the history of it, because the overall title for these four lectures is A History of the Infinite, and what I'm doing is looking at these issues in largely historical terms, and the history of the calculus is particularly interesting. And as you can see from the next paragraph on the handout, there were two brilliant mathematicians in particular, Isaac Newton and Gottfried Leibniz, who were especially significant as far as the history of the calculus is concerned, because each of them can lay claim to having been the inventor of the calculus. These were two 17th century mathematicians. Newton was a brilliant scientist as well. Leibniz was also very famous for being a brilliant philosopher. But they both were also famous and very brilliant mathematicians. And each of them independently invented the calculus. They had rather different methods and they used very different notation. But the basic ideas of the calculus were there in the work of both Newton and Leibniz. And it's generally acknowledged nowadays that this is something that they did quite independently of each other. But at the time, there was a bitter dispute between them and between their followers about who really got there first, who can lay claim for having been the real inventor of the calculus. And in particular, Newton was suspicious of Leibniz because Newton thought that Leibniz had plagiarized, taken Newton's ideas and claimed them as his own. Let me at this point scroll down before I go any further. And what we now have is some material in red, because what I'm now going to give you is two quotations, one from Newton and one from Leibniz. And I've chosen two quotations from each of them towards the end of their lives. And I've chosen these two quotations because what they illustrate is a kind of weariness that you find in each of them at the end of these long, bitter disputes. I think there's a sense in which they both eventually just got tired of the whole business and wished that it had never happened. I mean, I'm sure ideally what each of them would have wished is that he alone had been the inventor of the calculus and that the other had never come across the same ideas. But you do find a kind of weary resignation in each of them at the end of their lives. And in particular, you find that in each of these quotations. So let me begin with the first quotation. And this is Newton. And Newton wrote as follows. I have never grasped at fame among foreign nations, but I am very desirous to preserve my character for honesty, which the author of that epistle. Now, let me interrupt straight away. I should just explain who it is that Newton is referring to at this point. So this is a response to an epistle or a letter by the Swiss mathematician Jean Bernoulli, who had written a letter in which he denounced Newton. He thought Newton was behaving irresponsibly throughout these disputes and was accusing Leibniz of all sorts of things that Newton should not have been accusing Leibniz of. So it's this letter by Bernoulli that Newton is referring to. And when he talks about the author of that epistle, that's who he has in mind. So let me go back to the quotation. I'm very desirous to preserve my character for honesty, which the author of that epistle, as if by the authority of a great judge, has endeavored to wrest from me. Now that I am old, I have little pleasure in mathematical studies, and I have never tried to propagate my opinions over the world, but I have rather taken care not to involve myself in disputes on account of them. So that's Newton at the end of his life. I think that really is quite disingenuous, if I may say so. When Newton claims at the end of that quotation that he has taken care not to involve himself in disputes on account of his opinions, that I think is simply not true. He had been involved in disputes earlier in his life with Leibniz, and they were quite bitter disputes, and Newton had certainly done his fair share to make them such bitter disputes. And meanwhile, we find Leibniz also showing weariness towards the end of his life. And here's what Leibniz says. And again, he's responding to things that have been published against him and accusations that have been made against him, accusations of dishonesty and plagiarism. And what Leibniz says is that in order to respond point by point to all the work published against me, I would have to go into much minutiae that occurred 30, 40 years ago, of which I remember little. I would have to search my old letters, of which many are lost. Moreover, in most cases, I did not keep a copy. And when I did, the copy is buried in a great heap of papers, which I could sort through only with time and patience. I have enjoyed little leisure, being so weighed down of late with occupations of a totally different nature. So both Newton and Leibniz are just fed up with the whole business, as you can see. The generally acknowledged view these days is that, in fact, Newton did get there first. Newton arrived at these ideas at some point in the 1660s, and Leibniz probably didn't arrive at them until about 10 years later, at some point in the 1670s. That's the consensus these days. But although Newton had done this work in the 1660s, he didn't publish it. For a long time, he was concerned to keep it secret, and until he had worked out the details and was confident that he knew exactly how he wanted to implement these ideas. So Newton got there first, but Leibniz published first. And before Leibniz had published anything about it, Newton did in fact communicate with Leibniz. And in particular, Leibniz was one of the few people that Newton was prepared to explain his ideas to. But of course, this was back in the days before there was such a thing as email. Communication was not instant. If you wanted to write to somebody, and in particular, if you wanted to write to somebody in a different country, you sent a letter and it would take quite a long time to arrive. And in particular, the communication between Newton and Leibniz took a long time to arrive because Leibniz himself traveled around a lot. And letters that were intended for him might have reached the destination where he was initially, but very often didn't reach the destination where he was by the time that they arrived. So it seems quite likely that Leibniz didn't receive Newton's letters until quite a long time after Newton had sent them. Leibniz had by then worked out very similar ideas, wrote back to Newton, I think probably celebrating the fact that they'd stumbled across the same ideas independently. But that was the point at which, when Newton received Leibniz's response, Newton began to suspect Leibniz of plagiarism, of stealing some of Newton's ideas. And that's the point at which it became very bitter and very controversial. And it wasn't just Newton and Leibniz themselves that were involved in this controversy. It was their various followers as well. And in some ways, the disputes between their followers were even more bitter than the disputes between Leibniz and Newton themselves. Now, let's go back to the mathematics of it, although still thinking of this in historical terms. There were these disagreements about who was responsible for the calculus and who deserved the credit for it. But there were other disagreements as well. And as you can see on the handout, there were disagreements in which the church got involved. Now, why should the church be involved? Well, and this has to do with the fact that a very early work on the calculus, which was carried out by a range of mathematicians, not just Newton and Leibniz themselves, very early work on the calculus, wasn't absolutely rigorous. And in particular, early mathematicians who were following the work of Newton and Leibniz did the thing which I said earlier they shouldn't really have been doing. They made use of infinitesimally small quantities. Now, I tried to explain earlier when I gave you the example of the train traveling and having a speed of 70 miles an hour at a particular point. I tried to explain then that we shouldn't be thinking of this in terms of infinitesimally small quantities, and that what the calculus really should be doing is helping us to see why we don't need to be thinking of this in terms of infinitesimally small quantities. But some of the early work in the calculus was not totally rigorous and didn't respect the mathematical constraints that it should have respected. And mathematicians did make use of these infinitesimally small quantities, and they made use of them in a way that was really incoherent, because they wanted to treat these quantities as if they were just like zero, just like nothing at all in some ways, but in other ways, not like zero. So if you added one of these infinitesimally small quantities to a particular measurement, that was supposed to make no difference. And in that respect, the infinitesimal quantity behaved as if it was the same as zero. On the other hand, they also thought that you could divide by these infinitesimally small quantities, and that only makes sense if they're not the same as zero, because division by zero is illegitimate. I mean, if you ask what's 3 divided by zero, the question just doesn't make sense. That doesn't have a value. So there were incoherences in the very early work on the calculus. And the reason that the church got involved was that one of the people who entered into discussion of the calculus was a bishop, also a very famous philosopher, Bishop Berkeley, George Berkeley. And he was interested in work on the calculus because one of the people who had been championing this work was the famous mathematician and scientist Edmund Halley, who is particularly famous for having discovered Halley's comet. And Halley had been celebrating this early work on the calculus, but he also was very anti-religion, anti-Christianity. And he denounced Christianity as involving a whole lot of incoherent and silly ideas. And Berkeley, who was a bishop, a member of the church, therefore, was aggrieved at this. He was aggrieved at the idea that here was this man who was denouncing principles of Christianity, and yet at the same time was championing this work in the calculus, which, as Berkeley saw it, was incoherent. And so Berkeley famously published a work in which he himself took issue with the calculus and explained why he thought it was incoherent. And he gave his work the following title. This is, believe it or not, the next piece on the quotation, on the handout, which is in red and which is there for a quotation. Believe it or not, this is the title of Berkeley's pamphlet, the title of Berkeley's essay. And he entitled it The Analyst. And let me just explain, first of all, what he meant by the analyst. By the analyst, he meant somebody who practices what he called analysis. And what he meant by analysis was that was his word for the calculus. The calculus was sometimes referred to as analysis or as the modern analysis. So what Berkeley means by the analyst is the person who practices the calculus and does work in the calculus. So the analyst, or a discourse addressed to an infidel mathematician, and that's Halley that he has in mind, wherein it is examined whether the object, principles, and inferences of the modern analysis, that's to say the calculus, are more distinctly conceived or more evidently deduced than religious mysteries and points of faith. And then what follows in the title is a quotation from the Bible. So the next bit is in quotation marks, and this is a quotation from the New Testament. This is something that Jesus said, "First cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." So this captures the idea. It's all very well for Halley to come along and start criticizing the church for having incoherent doctrines. Basically, what Barclay is saying, you know, first of all, look at the incoherent doctrines that you subscribe to when you're practicing the calculus. And the next bit is also in red. This is quite a long quotation, and this is Barclay again. This is a quotation from this essay in which he explains some of his reservations about the calculus. So what you'll find in this quotation, he talks about increments vanishing. And what he means by that is small measurements getting closer and closer to zero until they actually reach zero and vanish completely. And that's the point at which he thinks the calculus comes in and starts trying to measure with these infinitesimally small units. So here's the quotation from Barclay. When it is said, let the increments vanish, i.e. let the increments be nothing, or let there be no increments, the supposition that the increments were something, or that there were increments, is destroyed. And yet, a consequence of that supposition, i.e. an expression got by virtue thereof, is retained. So this is Barclay making the point that I made earlier, that we're sort of pretending that we've got something that is zero in some ways and yet is different from zero in other ways. When we suppose the increments to vanish, we must suppose their proportions, their expressions, and everything else derived from the supposition of their existence to vanish with them. And what are fluxions, asks Barclay. And fluxions was the term that Newton used for rates of change. That was a bit of terminology that Newton introduced. What are fluxions? The velocities of evanescent increments. And what are these same evanescent increments? They're neither finite quantities, nor quantities infinitely small, nor yet nothing. May we not call them the ghosts of departed quantities? So that's Barclay explaining why he thinks that the calculus is disreputable, incoherent. And to be fair to Barclay, his criticisms were justified because some of the early work on the calculus was incoherent. And it wasn't really until quite a bit later in the 19th century that mathematicians introduced the kind of rigor that was necessary to make those methods suitably coherent and suitably precise. But to be fair to Newton and Leibniz themselves, both Newton and Leibniz had a much clearer and much better understanding of what was involved, and they knew that it wasn't really a matter of dealing with infinitely small quantities, that it was a matter of dealing with ever smaller finite quantities. And so here's a quotation from Newton to show that he did have a good, sound understanding of the principles of the calculus. So Newton writes as follows, in the method of fluxions, and there's that term again, Newton's term for rates of change. In the method of fluxions, there is no need to introduce infinitely small quantities. These ultimate ratios with which the quantities vanish are indeed not the ratios of ultimate quantities, that's to say infinitesimal quantities, but limits to which the ratios of quantities varying without limit always approach, to which they may come up more closely than by any given difference, but beyond which they can never go. And by the time these ideas had been made precise in the 19th century, we see that what Newton is expressing there is something very much like the kind of precision and rigor that later mathematicians introduced into the calculus. Now, let's turn our attention to the infinitely big. Scientists, and not just scientists, philosophers have always been concerned with the infinitely big as well as the infinitely small. And in particular, the question arises, are space and time infinitely big? Do they go on forever? Are there infinitely many stars in the universe? Is the universe, the physical universe itself, infinitely big? What are we going to say about these questions? And over the 2,500 years that I've been concerned with in these lectures, there have been many attempts to address these questions. And in particular, we can go all the way back to the ancient Greeks for the next quotation. This is an ancient Greek thinker called Archytas, who was a friend of Plato, lived at the same time as Plato. So he's a 4th century BC thinker. And he presented a very simple but very compelling argument for the idea that the universe must be infinitely big, must be of infinite spatial extent. And the argument goes as follows. If I am at the extremity of the heaven of the fixed stars, can I stretch outward my hand or staff? So he's imagining that there is an edge, and he's imagining what happens if he's at the edge. And he raises the question, well, what if he tries to stretch out his hand or to stretch out his staff? And he says, it's absurd to suppose that I could not. And if I can, what is outside me must be either body or space. We may then, in the same way, get to the outside of that again, and so on. And if there's always a new place to which the staff may be held out, this clearly involves extension without limit. I mean, there could be something preventing him from stretching out his hand or his staff, but I think the idea is that if there were, that would just be another physical object. And if there weren't, that would be because there was empty space there. But either way, Archytas's view is that it's incoherent to suppose that you've ever got to the edge, and so space must be infinitely big. Now, we talked a lot in the first lecture about Aristotle, and this is another issue that Aristotle himself addressed, and he disagreed with Archytas. Aristotle's view was that the universe is finitely big, and indeed Aristotle would have said that space itself is only finitely big. So the question arises, what is Aristotle going to say in response to Archytas's argument? I mean, if space is limited in size, what is limiting it? What is there outside space? That's a very natural thought, and that's basically Archytas's thought. If Aristotle is insisting that space is limited, must there not be some story about what's limiting it? And if there is some story about what's limiting it, then doesn't it mean that space is not only finite after all? That's essentially Archytas's argument. But here's how Aristotle thinks he can respond to that argument. And he writes as follows. Belief in the infinite comes partly from this consideration. There must be no ultimate limit if everything limited is always limited by something different from itself. So that's Aristotle admitting that Archytas's argument has some force. He can see the appeal of the argument. And here he is admitting that that's one reason why people do believe in the infinite and do believe in the spatially infinite. But, says Aristotle, there's a difference between touching and being limited. The former is relative to something and is the touching of something. So if something is touched, there has to be an answer to the question, what's touching it? But the quotation continues, on the other hand, what is limited is not limited in relation to anything. So if something is limited, Aristotle says, there doesn't have to be an answer to the question, what's limiting it? Its limits can be internal limits. They can be part of its very own nature. So Aristotle believes that space can be limited, finite in size, without being limited by anything else. And that's how he tries to get round Archytas's argument. And those of you that attended my first lecture will realize why this is so important for Aristotle, because if space were infinite, then of course that would be an example of an actual infinity. That would be an infinity that was present all at once. And we saw in lecture one that that's exactly what Aristotle wants to deny. He wants to deny that there is any actual infinity. So it's very important for Aristotle that space should be only finite in extent. Now, interestingly, nearly 2,500 years later, we find physicists saying something very, very much like what Aristotle wanted to say. These days, a lot of physicists believe that space is finite. A lot of physicists believe that space is limited in size without being limited by anything else. Now, I'm not claiming that Aristotle had already anticipated what 20th and 21st century physicists wanted to say. We mustn't think that Aristotle was thinking in exactly the same terms as contemporary physicists. Nevertheless, it is striking that Aristotle's idea has a kind of echo in what 20th and 21st century physicists are prepared to say. And I'll talk a little bit about that later. But it is striking, partly because a lot of you may be looking at Aristotle's argument and still puzzling over it and thinking, well, how can space be limited without being limited by something outside? And if there's something outside, then that means that we haven't actually got a finite space after all. But the disputes about whether the universe was finitely big or infinitely big continued. And in particular, Kant, the famous 18th century philosopher Immanuel Kant, entered into this dispute. Now, he disagreed with Aristotle in as much as he took for granted that space was infinite. There was never any question in Kant's mind that space did extend infinitely far. But what Kant was interested in was not the question whether space was infinite, but the question whether its contents were infinite. What about the physical universe in space, the world as a whole, meaning by the world, not planet Earth, but the whole of the physical universe? Was that finite or infinite? The sheer fact that space is infinite doesn't settle that question, because you might think, well, it could be a finitely big universe surrounded by infinite empty space. So Kant entered into this controversy, and he raised the question whether the universe was finitely big or infinitely big. And strikingly, Kant thought that the answer was neither. He thought that we could say that the universe was neither infinitely big nor finitely big. So let me turn to the next quotation on the handout from Kant itself, in which he summarizes his ideas. So Kant writes as follows: if I inquire as to the spatial magnitude of the world, and remember, by the world here, he means the whole of the physical universe. This is not a question about planet Earth. If I inquire as to the spatial magnitude of the world, it is equally impossible to declare it infinite or to declare it finite, for neither assertion can be contained in experience, because experience either of an infinite space or of the boundary of the world by a void space, an empty space, either of those is impossible. The magnitude of the world, decided either way, would therefore have to exist in the world itself apart from all experience. But this contradicts the concept of a world of sense, which is merely a complex of the appearances whose existence and connection occur only in experience. So let me see if I can try to explain what's going on there, what Kant is doing in this quotation. Basically, what Kant is doing is defending his own idea that the physical universe has no existence at all apart from what we can experience of it. Kant believed that physical reality was ultimately a matter of what could be experienced, and there's nothing to physical reality beyond what can be experienced. And sometimes he put this by saying that the physical world is just a matter of appearance, or that the physical world just is appearance. That's to say, it has no reality over and above how it appears. And so the reason why Kant thought that he was in a position to say that the physical universe was neither infinite nor finite was because he thought there couldn't be experience of either. If the universe was infinitely big, that's not something that we can experience. We can only ever experience finite portions of the physical universe. On the other hand, if the universe was only finitely big, surrounded by empty infinite space, that's not something that we could experience either, says Kant. You might, as it were, see the edge of the physical universe, and you might turn your attention away from it and look out at infinite empty space, but you wouldn't be able to know that that's what you were looking at. For all you know, there's stuff out there that's so far away that you can't see it. There can't be any direct experience of infinite empty space. Neither of these things can be experienced, so neither of them has any reality. And Kant thinks that he can get round the problem of how to decide whether the physical universe is infinitely big or not by saying that it's neither. Now, I'm going to go backwards in time. I'm going to go back to Newton. So this is earlier than Kant. We're going back to the 17th century. But Newton is again significant because this is another question that he addressed. And interestingly, he had an argument for the view that the universe, the physical universe, is infinitely big. One of the reasons that this is particularly interesting is that the dispute that I was talking about earlier between Newton and Leibniz generated a much wider dispute between their followers. There were Newtonians and Leibnizians who disagreed with each other about all sorts of things. And in particular, one issue that they disagreed with each other about was the issue of whether the universe is finitely big or infinitely big. And the reason that this is particularly interesting is that most Newtonians actually disagreed with Newton himself. The standard view of the Newtonians was that the physical universe was finitely big, but that wasn't Newton's own view. Newton's own view was that the universe was infinitely big in extent. And what we find in the next quotation on the handout is Newton's reason for thinking this. So let me now read out this quotation from Newton. It seems to me that if all the matter in the universe were evenly scattered throughout all the heavens, and the whole space throughout which this matter was scattered was finite. So you're imagining, it may be very, very big, but you're imagining a finite universe, you know, full of stars and planets and such like, but nevertheless finite, with these heavenly bodies evenly distributed throughout the space. If it was like that, says Newton, the matter on the outside of this space would, by its gravity, tend towards all the matter on the inside, and by consequence fall down into the middle of the whole space and there compose one great spherical mass. So that's Newton's argument for you. He's saying, look, if there were only finitely many physical objects in the universe, if the physical universe were only finitely big, it would by now have become a huge great blob. But that's not what we see. We look up at the heavens and we see separate stars and we see separate planets. And Newton concluded that the universe was infinite in spatial extent. Now, as I've already mentioned, if you ask most contemporary physicists what their view is, the contemporary view is that space is finite but unbounded. And many of them are prepared to say that time is finite as well. And one very popular view, a view that I'm sure that most of you will be familiar with, is that everything began with a big bang about 15,000 million years ago, where a lot of physicists would be prepared to say that wasn't just the beginning of the physical universe, that was the beginning of time itself. And one view is that eventually this process will reverse, that you had this big bang and what we are is basically debris from this cosmic explosion that took place 15,000 million years ago. And the view of some physicists is that eventually, I mean, we're still sort of expanding away from that big bang, but eventually that process will stop, turn in on itself, and there will ultimately be a big crunch. And as far as the question how it's possible for space to be finite but unbounded. Let's forget about time for the time being. I mean, we can come back to that in the question and answer session if people want to. But let's think specifically about space. How is it possible for space to be finite but unbounded? Something that Aristotle believed. The way that contemporary physicists often explain this is they say, well, it's a bit like what it would be like for two-dimensional beings on the surface of a sphere. So imagine planet Earth, which is obviously roughly spherical. Imagine the surface of that planet. And imagine two-dimensional beings, shadows, if you like, crawling along that surface. So these are unlike us. I mean, we exist in three dimensions, but imagine these two-dimensional beings and suppose that their whole universe was the surface of the Earth. And imagine that some of them were physicists and were interested in exploring the space throughout which they moved. What they would eventually decide, the conclusion that they would eventually come to, was that their space was finite but unbounded. The surface of the Earth is finite. It has a particular surface area. We can say how big it is. But it is unbounded. There's no edge. And if you travel from a particular point on the surface of the Earth and keep going forever, let's imagine that's something that you can do. So let's imagine that you're able to travel across the oceans in two dimensions. Keep going forever. Well, I say keep going forever, but in fact, what would eventually happen is that you would eventually arrive back at your starting point. And you would think that you had been traveling in a straight line away from that starting point, but your journey would bring you back to that starting point, and that's because your space was finite but unbounded. So physicists, a lot of physicists say it's a bit like that for us. It's as if our three-dimensional space is like their two-dimensional space. And if you traveled far enough in what you took to be a straight line from any particular point in space, eventually you would arrive back at that same point. And this is just one example of something that's very striking in modern science, which is that we find in contemporary science, something very much like what we found in lecture one when we were considering early Greek thought about the infinite, namely a kind of abhorrence of the infinite. Scientists mistrust it. Mathematicians are quite happy talking about the infinite, but scientists are always suspicious when they come across the infinite. And as I say on the handout there, whenever the infinite appears in any of their calculations, this forces them to think again. If they've got equations that look as if they have to make use of the infinite, typically what scientists do is reconsider their equations or reconsider the application of those equations to physical reality. They're suspicious of the infinite. They're wary of the infinite, in very much the same way that ancient Greek thinkers were suspicious of the infinite and wary of the infinite. And I'm almost finished, but what I want to do finally, the very last thing that I want to do, is finish with a quotation from the 20th century physicist Arthur Eddington. And this is a significant quotation, simply for the reason that it illustrates the point that I was just making. It's a nice illustration of the way in which 20th century physicists shied away from the infinity, and tried to do their best to avoid it. And this is Arthur Eddington talking in particular about Einstein, probably the most famous scientist of all time, and the way in which Einstein in particular wanted to avoid infinity. So let me just finish with this quotation from Arthur Eddington. "There was just one place where Einstein's theory did not seem to work properly, and that was infinity. I think Einstein showed his greatness in the simple and drastic way in which he disposed of difficulties at infinity. He abolished infinity. He slightly altered his equations so as to make space at great distances bend round until it closed up." So that's the idea that I was talking about earlier. It's as if our three-dimensional space is like the two-dimensional space on the surface of a sphere, bending round until it meets itself again. So that if in Einstein's space you keep going right on in one direction, you do not get to infinity, you find yourself back at your starting point again. Since there was no longer any infinity, there could be no difficulties at infinity. QED. So that's a really striking quotation and a really striking illustration of how physicists have tried to avoid infinity, or as Arthur Eddington puts it, not just avoid infinity, but abolish infinity. It'll be very different next time. In lecture 3, we will turn our attention to what mathematicians have wanted to say about the infinite, and they haven't abolished it, but scientists are much more wary of the infinite. So let me stop at that point and let me stop sharing.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Adrian, for that wonderful lecture. Now we will have 3/4 of an hour for discussion. And we will begin, as announced, with our panel discussion. I will briefly introduce our panelists again. And I invite all of our panelists to open their videos if they want. I'll follow alphabetical order. So I'll start with Professor Chenbo. Professor Chenbo is Chair Professor of Humanities and Social Science in the School of Philosophy at Wuhan University. Until September 2021, very recently, he was professor of philosophy at Peking University. He's an elected member of various international academies of philosophy, and he's been a visiting scholar and professor at many of the best universities around the world. His research is mainly in logic and analytic philosophy, especially philosophy of logic, philosophy of language, history of logic, theory of knowledge, American pragmatism, Hume, Frege, Russell, Quine, and Kripke. He is the author of many books and articles, and he has also authored several comparative studies between Chinese philosophy and Western philosophy. Professor Mei Jianhua from Shanxi University is also the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Human Cognition. He works mainly in philosophy of mind, philosophy of AI, experimental philosophy, and metaphysics. He is also interested in Chinese philosophy, philosophy of language, Wittgenstein, and philosophy of children. He has published research articles on an equally broad range of topics, including consciousness, physicalism, causal inference, artificial intelligence, experimental semantics, and philosophical methodology. Professor Sun Yongping is an associate professor in philosophy at Peking University, and he is the director of philosophy of science and technology in the Department of Philosophy. His research and teaching are mainly in philosophy of science and history of science and philosophy in the early modern period. Dr. Yan Xunling is a postdoctoral fellow at the Institute of Philosophy of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. She has recently obtained her doctorate from the University of Virginia. She works mainly in philosophy of physics, with a focus on foundational issues of quantum mechanics. She's also interested in space-time, particularly the question of how various physical theories handle the notions of space, time, or space-time. Welcome again to all of our panelists. Now, the way we will proceed today is in the following way. Each of our panelists is going to share some of their comments, questions, or perhaps criticisms of Professor Moore. And afterwards, Professor Moore is going to answer all of them. Now, whoever wishes to go first could perhaps raise their hand or just begin.
Okay.
Professor Chan, thank you. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Professor Moore, for your informative and interesting talk. My question about the infinitely big. For the ordinary fools, it makes sense to talk about the qualities, the boundaries, the beginning and ending of its parts, and also the relationship between its parts. For the biggest whole, that is the universe, include everything in time and space. Does it still make sense to talk about its quality, its boundary, and its limited or unlimited, something like this? My worry is maybe low, because the universe as an infinite is very different, is radically different the ordinary sense. For the ordinary sense, their qualities, their boundaries, their beginning and ending, except, but for the universe and the infinite, I think we should invent another way, a new way to talk about the infinite. Different that way we talk about the finite. That's my question. Okay.
Thanks very much, Professor Chen. Who would like to go next? Professor Sun, yes, please. You can open your microphone.
Okay, thank you, Professor Moore. I have two questions. One question is about the dispute, priority dispute between Newton and Leibniz about the calculus. Do you think this dispute has anything to do with their different or their conceptions about the infinite, the infinity? What do you think is their key differences in their conceptions about infinity? That's my first question. The second question is, in the end of your lecture, you quote Arthur Eddington's view about Einstein's general relativity. And you said this reflects a general worry of scientists in the 20th century about infinity. But do you think this is still the case in today's physics or in today's cosmology? Well, that's my two questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Professor Sun. Who would like to go next? Can I ask Dr. Yan? I think Professor May wants to go. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Moore. It's a great talk. And recently, I read your book. The evolution of modern metaphysics makes sense. It's great. Okay. I have two questions. One is about this talk. The other is maybe about related with the first talk, but I want to ask. Okay. The first question is about, first is about mathematics. Is there infinity in math in nature? If not, why can inflated continuous mathematics be applied to it so effectively? That's my first question. Oh, okay.
I'm sorry, I think it's possible that we just lost Professor May. Perhaps
some network problems.
Yes, I think so. Dr. Yan, would you like to take over at this point? Okay, thanks very much.
Sure. So thank you for the lecture, Professor Moore. It was very interesting. So I have a comment on infinitely small. But first of all, you mentioned that physicists are usually suspicious about the infinite, and they try to get rid of the infinite by putting a limit on maybe the length, maybe the boundary of our universe. So let me just begin with quantum gravity, because quantum gravity suggests that there is a minimal length to space, to objects. We cannot infinitely divide things up. There's a minimal length which we can get to, which is the Planck constant. So it's like 10 to the minus 35 centimeters or meters. I cannot remember the exact unit, but it's really small. And that's the smallest unit we can get to. So if that's the case, it would suggest that our universe is sort of discrete rather than continuous, as some people would think. So because things can only come in discrete chunks or discrete units. So you can add up those little small space to constitute a huge space, so to speak. So one of the implications about there is a minimal length of objects or universe is to say that the world is discrete rather than continuous. So my question is this. So is the debate between the infinite and finite has anything to do with the debate between continuity and discreteness? Because quantum gravity seems to give an answer or implication for that. So I'm not sure if people working on infinite, because you are an expert on infinite. So so maybe you can say something about how these two debates kind of overlap or they are diagonal to each other. And part of the reason why I'm kind of worried about this is because when you were talking about calculus, you said that calculus is about rate of change, is about, for example, the speed of a moving car at a certain point. It seems like calculus give us a tool to calculate speed at any point or at any space-time point. But that's a problem, because if calculus concerns about continuous variation of objects set through space-time, and this seems to go against with this discreteness idea that quantum gravity is giving us. So that's my first comment. My second comment kind of sort of concerns with your the idea about the universe being finite but it's unbounded. So it's saying that the Einstein or maybe scientists is putting a limit to where the universe is going to end. And then you mentioned that they sort of connect with Aristotle's distinction between actual infinite and potential infinite. And they offers an answer, physicists offer an answer to whether this actual infinite exists. And the answer is no. So I was wondering whether physicists has anything to say about this potential infinite, or whether these are just two different topics. So that's my comment/questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. Now, I hear from Professor May that he can still hear us. And I also have a message from him. Perhaps I can read out his second question. I think he could not quite give us that second question. So just 1 second, I've got it right here. The second question, he says, I think he mentioned this, is really about the fourth lecture, I think. He says, it may be beyond the scope of this talk, but he still wants to ask this question. So when you talk about the infinite, one is about infinitely small, the infinitely small in mathematics, and the other, the infinitely big in physics, space and time. In the Chinese philosophy tradition, the human being is finite, but the human mind is infinite. It seems that there are two different kinds of the infinite. One is about the natural world, and the other is about the human mind. So what do you think the relation between the infinite of, or in the form of the human mind, what do you think is the relation between the infinite in the form of the human mind and the infinite in the natural world? That is the second question. Okay.
Thank you very much for these questions. These are excellent questions. I have to confess before I go any further that I wasn't hearing all of the questions very distinctly, and I'm not absolutely sure that I grasped the questions. I think I understood what people were asking, but there was a bit of a technical problem, and if I say something in response that's irrelevant, then that's probably because I didn't properly grasp the question. And so you can come back and correct me and tell me what the question really was. But let me address the questions in the order in which they arose. And first of all, Chen Bo's question. Now, this is one that I was struggling to hear, I'm afraid. So my apologies if I have misunderstood. But I think, if I'm correct, I think you were raising the question, what exactly is involved in talking about the extent of the universe as a whole, because this is very different from talking about the measurement of ordinary things. I mean, you can say how big a desk is, you can say how big a mountain is, you can say how big the sun is, but what's involved in saying how big the universe as a whole is? Am I right in thinking that was your question? Yeah. And so now this, sorry, are you trying to say something? You're muted.
My question is this, we can talk about the finite and the infinite in the similar way or the even in the same way? My question is this way,
This reminded me of very much of Kant. This was the idea that we found in Kant, that there is something problematical about applying certain ideas to the universe as a whole, which can certainly be applied to ordinary finite objects, because those ordinary finite objects can be objects of experience. I mean, you can look at a desk, and you can look at a mountain, and you can even look at the sun. I mean, the sun is huge, but we can see it. We can see it up there in the sky. Kant's own suspicion about questions concerning the size of the universe as a whole was grounded in the fact that the universe as a whole is not an object of experience. Now, nobody admires Kant more than I do. Kant is my favorite philosopher. But I have to say, I think this is one area in which he did make a basic mistake. And the basic mistake that I think he made was the mistake of thinking that just because something can't be an object of experience, we can't apply empirical methods to it. I mean, he himself talked about questions of the size of the universe as if they were non-empirical questions, as if they were philosophical questions that we should be able to settle just by sitting and thinking about the issues in our armchairs. And I think what subsequent scientific progress has shown very clearly is that these are scientific questions. These are questions for people to answer who are prepared to do the relevant experiments. And there are relevant experiments, and these experiments can be brought to bear on the question of whether the universe is infinite in extent or only finite in extent. And as it happens, most physicists these days would say that it's finite in extent. That's the contemporary orthodoxy. And you're not measuring the universe in quite the same way that you would measure a table, or even in quite the same way that you would measure the sun. But it doesn't follow that those questions of measurement can't be raised at all and can't be answered at all. Now, the second question, Sun Yongping raised a question about the dispute between Leibniz and Newton concerning the origins of the calculus. And the question was there actually a dispute about the calculus itself? Did they also disagree about the mathematical issues? Did they disagree about the infinite? There was certainly this disagreement between them about whether Leibniz had stolen Newton's ideas or not, but did they also disagree about the best way to formulate those ideas? And I think it's fair to say no. I don't think there was disagreement as far as that goes. They had very different approaches to the calculus. They presented the calculus in very different ways. And Newton's approach was a little bit more geometrical than Leibniz. Newton had made greater use of geometrical analogies and geometrical methods. And Newton's approach was much more the approach of an algebraist. And they had very different notation as well. And as it happens, it's Leibniz's notation that has survived through to the present day. But when each of them looked at the work that the other was doing, they would have recognized it as perfectly legitimate work, and they would have recognized its significance, and they would have accepted it in mathematical terms. And indeed, that's part of the reason why Newton was so aggrieved, because I mean, he wouldn't have been as upset if he had thought that Leibniz was presenting something incoherent. But he thought that Leibniz was presenting something that made good mathematical sense, and actually was made good mathematical sense because it was based on his own ideas. Now, the second question that Sun Yongping raised was a question that followed on from the quotation that I gave from Eddington. That quotation showed how 20th century physicists were suspicious of the infinite. And the question was, are physicists still suspicious of the infinite? Are they still wary of the infinite? Interestingly, Yan Chung Ling answered that question for me because the very first point that you made was that we do find in contemporary physics a continuing wariness of the infinite, and we find talk of in quantum mechanics, we find talk of Planck's constant. You mentioned Planck's constant, but talk of discrete units at the very tiniest level. The idea seems to be that both space and time themselves come in tiny units, discrete chunks, and there's a minimal unit of space and a minimal unit of time, perhaps. I mean, one has to say perhaps, because nothing is completely uncontroversial, and physicists themselves are not totally agreed about any of these issues. But that is a popular view, and it's a further illustration of physicists making sense of things in very finite terms. So that's an interesting answer to the previous question. But of course, it does raise a question of its own. And this is a question that Yan Chung Ling did raise, which is, how does that relate back to the calculus? Because there I was at the beginning of the lecture, trying to convince you that the calculus was of huge importance because of how it had been applied in science and technology. And in particular, I had the example of the train traveling 60 miles in an hour, and how we might go about making sense of the idea that its speed at a particular point is 70 miles an hour. And what I did was try to emphasize that that the point that we're interested in is not a point with any dimensions. We're not talking about a chunk of time, and we're not talking about a chunk of space. And yet, if quantum mechanics is right, perhaps we should be talking about a chunk of time, and perhaps we should be talking about a chunk of space. And I think the answer to the question has to be that even if that is right, even if the lesson of quantum mechanics is that space and time are discrete rather than continuous, the calculus is still of huge importance and still has huge practical significance, because physicists and engineers and technologists can do what they've always done, which is they can work with idealizations. Very often you have to pretend that the universe is a certain way, even though you know it's not exactly that way. You have to develop a certain model of the universe so that you can go on to consider what the basic laws of nature are and how they can be exploited in technology. So, for example, we find physicists talking about what happens if something is moving along a frictionless surface. And that's a perfectly legitimate thing for them to do, and it can have real practical significance, even though, in fact, we know that there are no frictionless surfaces. If anything is moving along a surface, there will be friction. So it's a kind of pretense. And I think what we would have to say is that if space and time are discrete rather than continuous, then the calculus is a kind of pretense as well, but still a pretense that can be of enormous practical significance. I think that would have to be the answer. Now, you did have another question, which was a question about the relationship between contemporary physics and the ideas of Aristotle. And this was a comparison that I myself drew. I said that this idea of finite but unbounded space can be found both in contemporary physics and in Aristotle, and that's striking, even though they're not necessarily understanding it in the same way. And in particular, I said it was important for Aristotle to talk in these terms because he wanted to reject the actual infinite. And if space were infinitely extended, that would be an example of the actual infinite. But I didn't talk about the potential infinite, and you're raising the question of whether there's any echo of that in contemporary physics. And I think probably the best way to answer that question is to recall something that I tried to emphasize in the very first lecture, which is that Aristotle himself thought of the actual potential distinction as a temporal distinction. Subsequently, it's been understood in rather different ways, but for Aristotle himself, this was a distinction about how the infinite appears in time. And as I tried to explain in the previous lecture, the actual infinite is an infinite that's present all at once. The potential infinite is an infinite that is extended over time. And so I think the question whether there's anything like that appearing in modern physics is going to depend on what contemporary physicists want to say about time. We've been focusing mostly on what they've wanted to say about space. And if they do end up convincing us that space is finite but unbounded, then that's very much in line with what Aristotle would want to say. But then what are they going to tell us about time? Now, there are some physicists who are inclined to the view that time is finite as well as space, that it began with a big bang and that it may end with a big crunch. Other physicists will tell a different story. Some physicists will incline towards the view that time is infinite. And even if they believe in a big bang and a big crunch, perhaps they think it's a process that keeps repeating itself. So the universe sort of expands and then contracts and then expands and then contracts and then expands and then contracts and keeps doing that indefinitely. So it's all going to depend on what they say about time. And whether their view is Aristotelian or not, I think, is going to depend on whether they think that time is infinite or not. And those physicists that want to claim that time itself is finite are disagreeing with Aristotle. Aristotle's own view was that time is infinite. And of course, he was able to say that because that's the potential infinite. That's the infinite extended over time. Now, let me turn to Maitreya's questions. I'm probably badly mispronouncing the name, I'm afraid. But now, your first question, I'm afraid that was another one that I had a little bit of difficulty hearing. But I think what you were asking, I think your first question was a question about how the infinite can be applied to nature. I mean, we've got the a sense of the infinite as a mathematical notion, and we'll be talking quite a lot more about that next time in my third lecture. But we also discussed it to some extent last time and in the first half of today's lecture as well, the way in which mathematicians think about the infinite. But the question arises, how does this mathematical work relate to physical reality, relate to nature? And I This was a question that cropped up in the Q&A session last time. And I said something which anticipates what I will be saying in lecture three. And I think perhaps it's worth repeating that. And we will come back to this in lecture three. But what we will see next time is we will see the kind of work that mathematicians have done with the infinite, where this is very much pure mathematics. And very often when people first encounter these ideas, their very first question is, does any of this have any application to physical reality? This is pure mathematics, but can it also be applied mathematics? And what I said last time, and it's perhaps worth repeating, is that the really serious mathematical work that's been done on the infinite and on the infinitely big, so I'm not now thinking about the calculus, but I'm thinking about the infinitely big, the really serious mathematical work is still relatively recent. I mean, it's 19th century work, 19th and 20th century work. But as far as these go, as far as these issues go, that still counts as relatively recent. And it's striking how often in the history of mathematics and the history of science, you find mathematics coming before its applications. The mathematical ideas are developed first by mathematicians, and then scientists subsequently find ways of applying those ideas. So I think it is possible that some of this mathematical work will have applications, even though we don't yet know what those applications are. But of course, that in turn is going to depend on whether physicists can overcome their distrust of the infinite. And one of the things that I've been trying to emphasize today is that physicists like to avoid the infinite when they can. And in that respect, they're reminiscent of early Greek thinkers, as we saw in the last lecture. And then the last question was a really, really interesting question about human beings. And the idea that although human beings are finite, the human mind in some ways is infinite. And I think I'm going to do what Sebastian predicted that I would do, which is refer to lecture four at this point. It is a fascinating question. But I think it's probably better if I don't say anything more about it now, not because it's a question that I have nothing to say about, but because I think those issues will come up again in lecture four. And perhaps when they do come up in lecture four, there will be an opportunity in the question and answer session to tie together some of the themes from all four lectures. And in particular, this question might surface at that point. But this does depend on me trying to remember this question. And I do have a lousy memory, I'm afraid. So if we get to lecture four and you feel as if this question still hasn't been answered, then please do come back at me at that point and put the question again, and we can revisit it at that stage. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, Adrian, for answering all of those questions in a very systematic and impressive manner. Thank you very much. And I want to say that if any of our panelists would like to come back, perhaps to respond briefly, then you're welcome to. And you can raise your hand if you do want to do this. Alternatively, of course, I can move on slowly to see whether anyone will raise their hand. And if not, perhaps to read out some of our questions from the audiences on, on YouTube and Bilibili, I can say that just like last time, there were many excellent questions, and that obviously means that there may well have been overlap with the excellent questions and comments that we had here on our panel, and indeed that is the case again. So there were questions about the perhaps relation between the infinite in mathematics and how that may or may not apply to reality. That's been spoken about quite a bit. There's one question which I believe we haven't in any way touched upon, and it's a question for clarification or perhaps elaboration a little bit on one of the philosophers that you talked about today, Adrian, and it's Kant. So that's just the question whether you can perhaps explain a little bit further that dilemma that Kant asserts there, the beginning of the quotation that you gave us. So perhaps I can read it out so that we remember just the first thing that he said. So he says, "Now, if I inquire as to the spatial magnitude of the world, it is equally impossible to declare it infinite or to declare it finite." That's the dilemma, and the question is, or it's a prompt, as it were, for you to explain it in a little bit more detail, if you would.
Yes, so Kant looked back over the history of thought about the infinite and saw various examples of people tackling the question about whether the universe was finitely big or infinitely big, and presenting what looked like compelling arguments in favor of their views. So there were thinkers who argued that the Earth was the universe was infinitely big, and they seemed to have compelling arguments in favor of that view. And there were other thinkers who argued that the universe was only finitely big, and they seemed to have compelling arguments in favor of their view. But one thing that Kant noticed was that actually, in fact, what they were really doing was not arguing in favor of their view. They were always arguing against the other view. So the thinkers who believed that the universe was infinitely big, really what their arguments were arguments as to why it could not be finitely big. And those thinkers who believed that the universe was finitely big, really what they were doing was arguing that it could not be infinitely big. And so each party to the dispute was trying to win the argument by arguing against their opponent. And Kant was really struck by these arguments because he thought they were compelling. Now, I think it's fair to say that these arguments have subsequently lost a lot of their appeal, partly because we're now much more comfortable with the idea that these are empirical questions. This was something that I tried to emphasize earlier. Nowadays, people think that you can't really answer these questions except in scientific terms. But at the time that Kant was writing, these looked more like philosophical questions than scientific questions. And the view was that you could answer these questions just by sitting in your armchair and reflecting. And if you sat in your armchair and reflected, it did look as if, at the time, it looked as if you could see reasons both for denying that the physical universe was infinite and for denying that it was only finite. Now, Kant presented these arguments. The truth of the matter is they're not very compelling. I mean, you can see the force of the arguments, but they're certainly not as compelling as Kant thought they were. But I think, and this is something that I've tried to emphasize in the lecture today. I think really what was going on there was that Kant's own sympathy for empiricism was coming out. I mean, really what he was doing was trying to convince us that we couldn't have experience of either alternative. So the universe couldn't be infinitely big because you couldn't survey something that was infinitely big. You couldn't have experience of an infinitely big universe. Similarly, the universe could not be finitely big because that would be something that you couldn't experience either. I mean, you might imagine sort of, I don't know, getting into a spaceship and zooming away from the universe until you were sufficiently far away that you could kind of look at it as some distant blob. But that's no good, says Kant, because, I mean, even if you could do that, you've then sort of got to turn round and look in the other direction and convince yourself that you're just looking at empty space. And you never could convince yourself of that. I mean, you might turn around and see nothing, but how do you know that that's not because there's stuff so far away that it's invisible to you? So Kant, I think, thought that these arguments were compelling. There was reason to suppose that the universe could not be infinitely big. And there was reason to suppose that the universe could not be finitely big, basically because you couldn't have experience of either alternative. So yes, people that had argued in this way were right to argue in this way. How did Kant solve the dilemma? Well, we don't have to think that they're disagreeing with each other, says Kant. They're both right. The universe can't be infinitely big and it can't be finitely big either. How come? How can they both be right? Well, because there's no such thing as the universe as a whole. I mean, that's Kant's solution to the dilemma. So it's a little bit like asking whether the King of France is bald or whether the King of France is not bald. That's an example that will be familiar to many people. It won't be familiar to everybody, but it'll be familiar to many of the audience. There's no such person as the King of France, and we might want to say that the King of France is neither bald nor hairy. And similarly, Kant says that the universe is neither finite nor infinite because there's no such thing as the universe. So that was how Kant contributed to this discussion. And as I said earlier, I am a great admirer of Kant. Kant is my favorite philosopher. I think Kant probably was the greatest philosopher of all time. But I do disagree with him about this because I do think, unlike Kant, that these are scientific questions and that they're questions that we should let the scientists answer, and the scientists do answer in their various ways.
Thanks very much, Adrian. That's very useful. I thought that analogy with the King of France was very useful indeed, as you said, to those who perhaps know of it. Now, I think there's time perhaps for just one final question. I think that you'll be able to answer it relatively quickly. Now, this one goes as follows. This person says, I want to know how you might think about the following line of thought. The line of thought is this. The world must be finite, because it seems impossible that our finite human beings understand the infinite. And the commenter also adds, this seems to be one justification for the Greeks' abhorrence of the infinite. What do you think about that, Adrian?
Good. It's very, very interesting that the word understand is used there. I mean, if the word had been experience rather than understand, then that would have been very reminiscent of the discussion that we were just having about Kant. If somebody had said the world must be finite because we can't experience the infinite, then that's just the sort of argument that we find in Kant. That's exactly what we were talking about just now. And Kant would have said, well, yes, that is a good reason for thinking that the universe is not infinite. But he would not have drawn the conclusion that the universe is finite. He would have wanted to say that it was neither. But this is a little bit different because the person that's put this question has used the word understand rather than experience. And so the question arises, does that make a critical difference? You might think that we can understand the infinite even if we can't experience it. And this does yet again point forward to later lectures, because one thing that I will be doing in lecture 3 is trying to say something about how mathematicians have tried to understand the infinite, even though they wouldn't necessarily want to claim that they've had any experience of the infinite. And we will also return to this question in lecture 4 as well, because a lot of people who have been interested in the infinite in terms of our own finite limitations have wanted to say that it's very striking that we can understand the infinite even though we can't experience it. There are things that we can understand but can't experience. A lot of thinkers have wanted to say that about the infinite. Now, of course, they may or may not be right. I mean, it remains to be seen whether we agree with them. But perhaps we can understand the infinite. And if we can, then this particular argument against the universe being infinite collapses. It is something that we can make sense of, even if we can't experience it. But the person who put this question is quite right to say that this is a line of thought that perhaps goes all the way back to the ancient Greeks. I mean, part of their suspicion of the infinite was they didn't really think they could understand it, didn't think that they could make sense of it. It didn't stop them from believing in it. we saw that with the Pythagoreans. I mean, they didn't deny the existence of the infinite. It's just they thought it was something bad. The sheer fact that we couldn't understand it meant that they rebelled against it, and they were only interested in things that we could understand. But they believed in the infinite. They weren't people that denied the very existence of the infinite. So there's all sorts of different ways in which that train of thought can pan out.
Right, thanks so much. And as you've said, you will come back to similar thoughts in the following two lectures. And so I think this is, given that we've run slightly over time, also the perhaps perfect note on which to end today's meeting, even though there have been many more questions and comments. But as I said at the beginning, all of those will be shared with Professor Moore. So thank you once again, Adrian, for your lecture and your great discussion today. And thanks to all of our panelists, too, for their wonderful contributions. Thanks to our audience for their questions and comments, and I'll say goodbye everyone, and see you soon. The next lecture will be on Wednesday. Okay, have a good weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you.